Sorry about this, guys. Got to move.
Right there.
Yeah, it works. Thanks.
Everybody ready? Okay. You don't have to hold any mics today? Okay. All right, we're good. All right, always check. Good afternoon. We are following up, as promised, on the lengthy police chase from last Friday. I'm going to turn it over very quickly to Chief Smith. He's going to go through a play-by-play. I just want to, again, commend the patrol officer who paid attention to a intelligence document, a BOLO, a Be on the Lookout document, that identified a particular car as a suspected to be involved in a shooting, a triple shooting the night before. So we got a young police officer paying attention to roll call, taking with him a BOLO document, and really just keeping his eyes open, and sees this car. And then he acts with a great degree of bravery and courage. And for a patrol officer so young and early into his career, you'll see on a body-worn camera footage that Chief Smith is going to play for you guys today, that he really maintained a great sense of calm, particularly for a young officer. So I look forward to you know, what the rest of his career has in hold for him. But really, really great job. And this could have been a lot worse, certainly a lot worse. But don't have many days like this, thankfully. But when we do, I'm at least pleased to see that the Baltimore police officers handled this thing in as close to textbook fashion as possible. And I think that speaks to their training. It speaks to their commitment. It speaks to their dedication to get this job done. So without further ado, I'll hand it over to Chief Smith, and we'll get right into it.
All right, so I'm going to detail the events that we have linked this suspect to. We put out his information on Saturday afternoon in reference to this case. And as the commissioner said, it was a lot that went into this. So I will play a video, and to include some of our aerial surveillance video, body camera footage. So I'll get into that in just a second. I'm not going to it right this second. So for the time being, we know that we had a non-fatal shooting on 2500 block of Edmondson Avenue last week at 3:15, December 8th. In that incident, a 31-year-old sustained a gunshot wound to his hip. At that time, again, we didn't have a lot to go on, but it was a drive-by style shooting. On December 14th, at about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we had a homicide in the 4500 block of Reisterstown Road. In that instance, a 21-year-old man, Martrell Harris, sustained a gunshot wound to his head and was pronounced deceased not shortly thereafter. We got a description of a gray four-door sedan in that case, and we know that that was a drive-by style shooting where a person held a gun out the window and began firing. Witnesses were able to give us a little bit of information in that particular case. On December 14th as well, about 6 o'clock in the evening, we had a triple shooting in the 900 block of Poplar Grove. This is at a corner store, some sort of corner store there. Two individuals outside and a person inside were shot. The person who died in that case is a person that worked in the location. The victim sustained a gunshot wound to the head and was pronounced deceased shortly thereafter. The two other non-fatal victims did not sustain life-threatening injuries, but they were ages 16 and 24. They were able to get to the hospital to seek treatment. We recovered evidence at that scene that was consistent with the evidence that we ultimately recovered as a result of this individual. On December 15th at about 11:10 a.m. in the 2200 block of Reisterstown Road, this is where the car stop began. In that area of Reisterstown and Fulton is where the car stop began. The officer initiated that traffic stop, and he had information which the commissioner described, the BOLO. He believed this vehicle fit the description. The vehicle also had like limo tint on the windows, so he pulled the vehicle over. What I'm gonna go through this body-worn camera footage as part of this, but just understand that I'm gonna have to skip ahead because it's lengthy, but we'll send it out to the desk as soon as possible. Just showing you a real quick map of some of the incidents as we talk about them. December 15th at about 11:20, 4400 block of Park Heights Avenue, we had a 50-year-old shot at. And in that scenario, it was glass shards. We thought that we had shooting victims there initially, but they were shot at. Then in the 3100 block of West North Avenue to 22, we had a 48-year-old who was inside of a business there who was shot in the leg. This was, of course, during this pursuit. And around 11:40 a.m., somewhere around that time at least, in the 5400 block of Wabash, a 57-year-old was struck as he sat in the passenger seat of a vehicle. That's the one that I described on Friday with life-threatening injuries. At the time, that's what we believed on Saturday. He was stabilized, and we expect him to make a recovery in reference to that. So again, just giving you a little bit of an overview of the areas. You'll see as I post his information, he lives in the 3000 block of Oakford Avenue, which is really not far from where some of the incidents occurred in the Northwest District in the Reisterstown Road area. So basically out of his, in his backyard. Again, just another aerial view of the area where some of these incidents are taking place. Everything was on the west side of the city, northwest, west, southwest, where these incidents were taking place. And that's where the pursuit ended. Ironically, on the same screen, you can see where the pursuit began. So the pursuit began and ended not far from one another. And when we see the video, we'll go through more. Yes, it was his girlfriend who we believe he was on the phone with at some point during this pursuit. And you'll see her run to the car. They grab each other, fall out of the car, and then he's taken into custody. This is the gun that we recovered, the handgun that was recovered in this case that we obviously believe was used to shoot and kill some of the victims. And that's the long gun that was used in this case that was also used in ballistic evidence was found in reference to this as well. So there's the suspect, Mashawn Vittorio Coran Carter, 30-year-old male, 3000 block of Oakford Avenue. That's in Baltimore's Northwest District. He's been charged with numerous counts of murder and attempted first and second degree murder in cases on Wabash, Poplar Grove, Edmondson Avenue, and Reisterstown Road thus far. Again, this is still an active investigation, so some of this can evolve as time goes on. But as it stands right now, he's been charged in these cases. All right, with that, give me 1 second. I can transition into the All right, so real quick before we get started, just want to give a setup because for the sake of brevity, had to trim some of this down. But this is the initial car stop. The suspect in this case is cooperative to begin with. And one of the words that's used a lot by civilians is routine traffic stop. This is where in the academy setting we say there's no such thing as a routine traffic stop. But this is what you would think is a routine traffic stop when he makes it. But he knows something's wrong. He knows something's up. He also recognizes this vehicle fits the description of a vehicle that was wanted in reference to a non-fatal shooting that had occurred on Edmondson Avenue. So what he's going to do is approach the driver, get the information that he gets, talk to him, backup will arrive. I might have to scrub through some of it, but just want to give you a little background. So he had documents ready to give the officer when the officer pulled up.
Hey, Sir, what's going on? Can you just open this up a little bit? Can you just open this up a little more?
So he's asking him to open his window up some more because he can't see anything inside the vehicle because it's pitch black?
Okay, but now you're getting pulled over again, so do me a favor, open these windows up real quick. Just so you know, everything is being recorded on body cam, okay? My name's Officer Lippy. Yeah, this says you were stopped, and this is your license, and that's all good. Well, do you have... All right, do you have registration for the vehicle? You got registration for the vehicle? Let me get that? Thank you, sir. What's your medical condition, my man?
I got like a little blind inside my eye can't take it.
All right. Do me a favor, just open these up real quick so I can look back there. Thanks, man. Just so I can see what's going on. You know, I can't see nothing with these. It's a nice tint job, I'll give you that much. It's a nice tint job, but it's a little bit too tint. You know what I'm saying? Okay, so car register to you? Cool. Where you living at?
It's on the high conservatory.
Okay, you still living there? Okay.
So the backup arrives and he relays what he believes is going on.
10-4, making that call now.
No!
And he's calling citywide shooting to see if they were looking for this particular vehicle.
I got all his info right here. Gave you this BS, like homemade doctor slip for the tin for a totally different vehicle, so that's an Illinois. So good with that. And the whole car reeks of weed. So my plan is pull him out. Search the car. I want to call citywide, see if they want us to do that first.
You all pick up this little leak first for 2015. We are.
You can hop in the car meanwhile. Stay warm at least. You got like blackouts in the windows.
It's in 2015.
We are
31. Call us. He is the contractor and the house female
trust
to live inside.
It's homemade. It's homemade. So, hey.
Hey,
what's going on? This is Officer Libby out of the Western. How are you?
2015.
Good. So I have a silver Lexus with dark tint, blackout tinted windows, possibly tinted taillights, and black painted rims. Stopped here in the Western. I believe a flyer went out. I don't have a copy of the flyer. It's a 2005 silver LS40. I'm sorry, 430. I know you guys were looking for it. I don't have a copy of the flyer with me, though. I just heard it was for a shooting. I remember seeing it. I do not remember what exactly.
So he's just trying to confirm the details about the shooting at this time and the vehicle that they're looking for. So that's kind of what he's going through with the detective or the person that's on the phone. So they're trying to have a conversation. Is it a citywide shooting case? Is it a homicide case? Just to make sure it's routed to the right person.
3-4-1-C. Yeah, can you just double check and see if anybody's looking for that?
So they're checking in to confirm that this is in fact the vehicle that they're looking for so they can get the appropriate detectives out to the scene.
Standing by, let's see.
So now...
You good up there? What you got?
Yeah, that was an accidental dial. I got what might be that silver Lexus they've been looking for. I don't know yet. I'm on the horn with Citywide right now. This guy's got a bogus medical thing for his blackout tinted car. It matches the description perfectly. He's valid, but the car reeks of weed, so I got my 1011 up here. I'm checking with Homicide and Citywide to see what they want to do with the vehicle. Either way, if they're okay with it, I'm going to pull him out, run through the car, do my whole bit, and we'll take it from there. But this may be the vehicle they're looking for. I'm not sure though.
So the officer was pretty confident that he had the vehicle, so he's doing everything really textbook at this point to ensure that the people were notified that need to be notified in reference to the investigation.
Yeah, that was just LT. I accidentally pocket dialed him, so we want to make sure it was okay. So all his stuff came back valid, but the car reeks of weed, so I want to pull him out and do his thing. He's checking right now. He doesn't even know if this is the car, if this is them, or if it's Thomas.
So he's going to go back up to the vehicle.
come back in a minute. He got me on hold. I'll call him back in a minute. Let's at least get this part done. Hey, sir. So listen, just gonna give you a heads up. Do me a favor right now. What I want you to do is I want you to turn the vehicle off and step out for me, okay? Hey!
You'll hear gunshots very shortly.
Northbound on Reisterstown, we're about to hit Glens Falls. Ma'am, can you see if Fox is up?
Your car is secured.
He's leaving the vehicle.
Call the information.
So Foxtrot was alerted, and this is Foxtrot getting the initial call. They proceed to the area and ultimately get up over top of the vehicle.
What's the status of the vehicle?
They've
arrested
Alex with dirty, dark tinted windows, black rim, tinted taillight. Be advised, the individual, occupied one time, has a rifle in the vehicle. We're just charged out of the vehicle. Right now, we're on, we just got Hillside Road.
I got the vehicle. Everyone stay on the air, please. Stay on the air. Let me call it out. All right. It's on Cold Spring Lane. It's going to be southbound on our westbound on Cold Spring Lane.
So this is Cold Spring and Wabash right there at the Metro Center?
It's making the left-hand turn on Wabash. 4300 back on Wabash. It's headed eastbound, southbound.
So this goes on for a bit.
All right, it's heading on Wabash. Actually, now it's Darvin. It's a Darvin entering westbound on Clifton.
So the observer's westbound calling out the location.
2600 block of Clifton. All right, just made a right-hand turn northbound on Duklin. Northbound on Duklin. Slowing down a little bit. Slowing down a little bit. Just shot spotted the vehicle. It's Glens Falls. Alright. Coming up on Warwick. He's found on Glens Falls.
Shot fired in that car. Be careful. Shot fired.
Alright, we got Warwick now. He's continuing eastbound on Warwick. And be careful, guys. Units are advised. Shots fired in the vehicle. Just be careful. Alright, it's eastbound on Glens Falls. We need to on the westward. Southbound. Guys, need to pull back, and we'll just continue calling it. If you don't feel safe, stop. Pull aside. We'll continue calling it. Alright? It's gonna be northbound. Northbound on McKean. 900 block of McKean. Northbound. He's coming up on the rigs now. Alright, he's not sure what to do. He's gonna be eastbound on the rigs. McKean. Going across Fulton now. Alright, northbound on Fulton again. Alright, still southbound on Reisterstown Road. And our Fox 09 is significantly slowed down. It's just a matter of the vehicle completely failed now. It's been smoking. Southbound on our Reisterstown Road, 3300 block. Let's go back up on our Jewel Park Drive. Alright, so now.
All right, so the arrest is going to take place very shortly. You'll be able to see on the screen, and we'll replay it, where his girlfriend was and her darting across the street as he's arriving. Right in the middle of your screen right now, you'll see someone starting to run across the road. Next to the white vehicle.
Complete stop at Glens Falls. Arrest is down. All right, Fox. Glens Falls, 1700 block. Vehicle to stop. Let's get some more units over there. They're taking them into custody now. Stop the vehicle. The vehicle is rolling. Stop the vehicle. Somebody jump in the vehicle and stop it. All right, Fox. 1800 block of Glens Falls. child's going to be in custody. All right, the vehicle is now stopped. The vehicle is stopped.
Hey, the kid, the kid, the kid, the kid.
All right.
Hey, Morgan, it's the kid.
All right, box 1030 to it, 1030 to it.
So that's canceling.
1032,
1032,
1800 block of Grand Falls Parkway,
suspect
in custody, weapon in custody.
And this is the body-worn camera footage picked back up at the point of the arrest. So chaos, absolutely. At that point, they had to search him quickly to make sure he didn't have any weapons on his person as they got him into custody. And during this entire incident, during one of the earlier portions of it, one officer fired 3 rounds at the suspect but missed, did not hit the suspect. That's a 10-year veteran officer who fired those rounds but did not strike the suspect. So he's been, again, taken into custody and has been charged accordingly in reference to all of the incidents. We don't have a motive for what he was doing, and that's something that we're still following up on. I know some of you were at his bail review earlier today. I'm not privileged to all of the details that might have been discussed at that, so we'll do our best. Questions?
What about that girlfriend? Any thoughts? I mean, how much danger did she put herself in? Have you ever seen something like that unfold that way before?
Well, as you can see, she had a heck of a grip on him. There's no doubt about that. She was holding on to him as they came out of the vehicle, and the officers had to basically pry them apart. But certainly it was, she put herself in the middle of harm's way. He was actively shooting, and make no mistake about it. And those weapons were readily available there. But apparently it was something that she might have been doing to talk him into giving up, surrendering. So they were in communication, so she knew that he was going to be coming up to that intersection. Albeit his car was falling apart, he was slowing down for a purpose. She knew where to go at the right time. Luckily, it ended this way. Again, we can't, say that was a great job, but luckily it ended the way it did and didn't cause further injury to anyone.
Did he use the rifle? Did he shoot the rifle?
Yes.
Did he shot the rifle?
The rifle was shot, yes, in several cases the rifle was shot. I don't have the ballistics on the scene, but the rifle was used on the homicide on Poplar Grove, and that was a drive-by. So during this pursuit, did he shoot that rifle? I don't, yes. Commission says yes.
So we have, on Friday, just to double back here, 5 separate shootings you said on Friday, and 2 people were shot, right?
Yes, 2 people.
In the days leading up to this, he was involved in 3 shootings, one of them being a triple and 2 murders, is what you're saying?
Yes.
Okay.
The one you hadn't mentioned before is Martrell Harris on Ricer Sound Road. You're saying he's responsible for that on the side as well?
Yes.
Okay. I've talked to family members who say that Mr. Carter has a mental illness, a diagnosed mental illness. They are... they want to hear from you as to whether or not you know if he is being evaluated for that, if he's received medicine that he is prescribed, things along those lines. Can you comment on that at all?
So, Kevin, he's in state custody right now, so we can't comment on that right now. You know, if that is the case, and I don't know it to be the case or not, certainly that's something while he's in custody that the Department of Correction officials, state officials, will evaluate.
And it's also important to point out that he's been criminally charged no less than 13 times in the state of Maryland. So, you know, the criminal justice system has held him accountable, or at least attempted to in certain cases.
What more do you know about the two weapons, especially the one with the obliterated serial numbers, and any idea of where he got them? Anything like that?
No, I don't have any information on that. He's prohibited from possessing them, but again, that doesn't change the fact that he had them, but I don't have a history on the weapons at this time.
Can you speak to the nature of the shooting at the Poplar Grove location? You said that the individual who passed away worked there, but you have yet to identify that individual?
He's East African, and we haven't been able to locate family at this time. So that's what our detectives are trying to do. We don't know if it's family locally or if all of his family's abroad. So we're trying to locate family.
And can you say in what capacity you worked at the store?
I don't know. I don't know.
So the handgun had an obliterated serial number, right? You put that out?
Barry reported it just now, so.
But the other gun, the rifle, what?
I don't have any history on the gun. I don't have any information on it right now. Do you have anything different?
Yeah, it takes a little bit of time, not much, but a little bit of time to get some of that information back. We don't believe that this man, it was in legal possession, obviously, of either one. So we're backtracking to see what we can learn about those two firearms.
So you believe that one of the weapons in the car may have been a murder weapon connected to another shooting?
Well, we know that the rifle was used in the Poplar Grove murder the night before this incident that we just described took place. So, and the weapons that were fired and struck people were the weapons that were in his car. We don't have any reason to believe, based on the footage that we have, that he discarded any weapons during the pursuit.
Have you identified any connections between Mr. Carter and any of the victims? Do you believe all of the shootings were at random?
And we're still following up on that. I mean, certainly during this pursuit, it doesn't appear that these were intended targets. What occurred on December 8th, it doesn't appear to be an intended target. What occurred on Poplar Grove is something we're still following up on.
And in terms of Marshall Harris on the 14th?
Yeah, we're still following up on that. Again, he lives in that vicinity, so that's something that we're still following up on.
Did Mr. Carter make any reference to a road rage incident?
I don't want to go into specifics of what he spoke about, but, you know, a single road rage incident turning into this level of rage overall is, you know, two different conversations. So whether one of these shootings was connected to road rage is something that we're still investigating, but I don't want to get into specifics that he might have given. He did confess to his involvement in these incidents as well.
In which incidents?
All of them.
Yeah, and ultimately, we just want to be careful. He'll be represented by the public defender or his own criminal defense attorney, and you know, they'll undoubtedly come up with some defenses for their client. But we that's not what we do. That's something that other folks do.
With what the city's going through, 331 homicides at the moment, this was out of the ordinary, and it added two more homicides to that number and a bunch more shootings, I guess. Do you want to talk about this in relation to what the city has been seeing more generally this year, and discuss it as an outlier or just another symptom of the same?
Well, I think the spree is certainly an outlier, Kevin, but I think it's not unusual for a single person to be responsible for shooting more than one person in the city. In this particular case, it just so happened to happen during a police pursuit, and it was closely after he had been involved in other shootings. But you know, we believe strongly believe that the shooters that we identify and arrest are not usually people who are possessing a gun for the first time or shooting someone for the first time. And you know, you all know, even our homicide victims average about a dozen arrests apiece in their lifetime. So we don't think that the pool of bad guys has necessarily grown. We think it's the same ones, and they're prone to repeat their criminal behaviors again and again and again until our entire criminal justice system, all pieces of it, eventually hold them accountable.
And you may have done this Saturday.
Mayor.
The other officer that was injured at the scene, once the car, what there was no indication, nothing was said exactly as to what happened to that officer, how he got injured. Do you know now?
I don't know now. That's something that I intend to find out with specificity before I begin to answer it. I believe it was during that apprehension. When the girlfriend goes up and gets the boyfriend out of the car, the car is still in drive, and those police officers are kind of, you know, moving in, and there's a pile of them. And, you know, thank God for body-worn camera, thank God for Foxtrot and their video capacities. But we think it happened sometime during that scrum. I don't think he was struck by the car. And I think initially that was the idea about papers flowing. I think initially that was the idea on the scene, but that he maybe was struck by the car, and I don't think he was struck by the car.
Have you guys spoke to the girlfriend at all?
So she's being treated as a witness by homicide detectives. I will say this, and I won't go further than this. She cooperated with homicide detectives, and they interviewed her at length late last week. She was very cooperative. And again, you don't see that very often. God bless her. I'm glad she's okay. I understand why she did what she did for someone who she loves. I understand. I'm just glad that it didn't get worse when she introduced herself into that setting. It could have been a lot worse.
Did she shed any light for detectives on how this whole thing developed and why?
I don't know with specificity, Brian. I just know that at some point during the pursuit and a good 45 minutes on the scene, I thought it was 25, it ended up being closer to 45 minutes, she became aware of the pursuit. Maybe she was watching television. I don't know. But then, thankfully, they got on the phone together, and you know, maybe she de-escalated this, and maybe he wasn't intending to ever stop. Maybe she, you know, played a role in making this scenario end better. As bad as it was, better than it could have ended. So maybe she had a significant role in that.
Because in the area, bus stops.
Oh.
You got kids over here that get out of school.
Yeah.
It could have really been.
Well, you think about back on Friday. This is, by the time we did the press briefing, it started snowing and the roads were covered. So we were minutes away from the snow beginning. We were minutes away from school letting out. While we were on the scene, school dismissed early. So, in the overall spectrum of things, if we're looking for any silver linings, it's the fact that this concluded before the snow began, before the kids got out of school, which would have been earlier. So, yes, Barry.
Did the girlfriend, is there any indication that she also talked with detectives about the incidents prior to and talked about those situations?